So let's talk about relevance. Without some way to navigate the big ball of wibbly-wobbly, timey-wimey stuff that makes up our everyday conversations, there's got to be guidelines pointing us in the directions our conversational companions want to go. But if someone asks you how long a night on Deryllium is, how do you know to give her a time and not just answer yes? Since our heads aren't bigger on the inside, we must know which inferences to make and which ones to throw away, picking and choosing only what's most relevant. But how can we figure out how we figure stuff out? I'm O.T. Lieberman, and this is the Ling Space.
Welcome to the Ling Space.
When we communicate, we try to get across a lot more than just the literal meanings of our words. So we need to look at our speech in multiple ways. Semantic studies how we put those core meanings together, while pragmatics focuses on how we use those meanings in context to convey all that extra stuff. For example, if someone asked the doctor, "Why do your companions leave?" and the doctor responded, "Some of them forget me," you'd probably assume that not all his companions forget him, even if logically he could have meant every last one. But we figure if he meant all, he'd have said so. Our ability to make these kinds of inferences follows from what philosopher Paul Grice called the cooperative principle. This principle explains why conversations are more than just strings of disconnected statements. Under this idea, some contributions are more appropriate than others, and some are just ruled out completely. Conversations work because each participant is headed towards the same goal. To make sure this actually happens, we follow a set of specific rules that make up the principle which steer us where we want to go. These are known as conversational maxims. For instance, we can assume that the doctor was obeying the maxim of quantity, which basically says, be as informative as you can. If he had believed that all his past companions had forgotten him, he'd have used all. But since he didn't, we're able to work out that he believes that only some of them did. But in order for a hypothesis to become a full-fledged scientific theory, it has to be testable. So, like, make predictions which can be confirmed or denied. And for each maxim to make specific enough predictions, their definitions need to be operationalized. Operationalization means turning something abstract into something concrete and measurable. So, like, if we want to talk about someone's health, one thing we might do is draw some blood and check various serum levels. Health is abstract, but if we can assign some amounts to it, it becomes easier to talk about. Beginning in the 1980s, a group of cognitive scientists did just that for the field of pragmatics, by developing relevance theory. Relevance theory uses Grice's maxim of relevance as a starting point. But Grice only ever gave a two-word definition, be relevant, and even admitted that it was hard to pin down what this meant precisely. What these researchers did was define it as a property, not just of sentences, but of all the possible inferences we might make from those sentences, too. That way, it becomes possible to assign different amounts of relevance to different ways of thinking, and that lets us explain why we draw certain conclusions and not others from what somebody says. So how do we calculate the relative relevance of all the possible paths of inference that we could go down? Well, at its heart, relevance is a balance between how effective an inference is versus how much effort it takes to compute. So, take our earlier example, where somebody asked the doctor about why his companions leave, and he said, some of them forget me. The inference that not all of them did might require a bit of logical reasoning to get to, but the effect is worth it because it increases the amount of useful information that we have. We take the inference to be a relevant one because we recognize that not all of them is logically compatible with some of them, and that this improves our knowledge of the situation. You can always compute other possible inferences, like, say, taking the pronoun them to refer to Time Lords, but it would take a lot more effort to get there, because the most salient topic under discussion is the doctor's companions, not his own species. That inference just wouldn't make sense in the given context. Because of the significant effort required to make that kind of leap, it's labeled irrelevant and ignored. So the idea is that we follow a certain procedure when figuring out what someone's trying to tell us. The plan we follow can take us on a trip through disambiguation, pronoun reference resolution, Gricean implicatures and the like, traveling along the path of least resistance, and finally stopping when our expectations of relevance in any given context are met. But where do those expectations come from? Well, the whole idea can be summed up in the principle of communicative relevance, which states that each and everything we say carries with it a presumption of its own optimal relevance. That means we assume that everything said is relevant enough for us to process, and beyond that, it's the most relevant it can be. So going back to our example, if we expect people to communicate as much relevant information as they can in a way that minimizes effort while maximizing effect, we expect the doctor to say all if he meant it. Since all his companions are potentially relevant, but he only mentions some of them, our inference that not all of them have forgotten him ends up satisfying our expectations. So relevance theory also gives us inroads to the maximum of quantity, not just relevance. So how can we see whether all these ideas about relevance are true? Well, since the 1960s, one of the most famous tests used to study the psychology of reasoning has been the Wason selection test. It's deceptively simple, really. You put four cards on a table in front of you, with numbers on the face of them and colors on the back. Two of the cards are face up and two are face down. Maybe one of them has a 6, another a 7, and the other two are red and blue. Your job is just to figure out which cards you need to turn over to check whether the following rule is true. If a card has a 6 on its face, then it has a red back. Go ahead, think for a sec. Okay, so you can't just rely on turning over the 6. You also have to turn over the blue card. Why? Well, if it has a 6 on the other side, it breaks the rule. But only about 10% of people get this right. And because of this, it's been argued that people aren't generally as good at logical reasoning as they might think. What's even more interesting is that when the task is framed in more realistic terms, say, where the rule you're testing is about the legal drinking age, people work it out way more often, well over 50% of the time. The classic explanation is that the drinking age version makes people think of rules instead of descriptions. So when people are presented with cards that have drinks on one side and ages on the other, they know that they can't just check the beer card to make sure that the age is over 18. They've got to turn over the card with the 16 on it too to make sure they aren't drinking beer. But what the pragmatics researchers showed was that even the results of less realistic versions of the task can be improved by using relevance theory. And this provides us with evidence that the theory gives a good description of how we reason about these kinds of if-then sentences. Specifically, the researchers found ways to manipulate either the effort or the effect of the different inferences that people could potentially make, based on the original rule. By carefully crafting the context, they showed that people typically choose the most relevant inferences to ground their decisions, junking other inferences that logically follow from the rule but have been tagged as irrelevant. To see exactly how this worked, let's go back in time to look at our original rule. If cards with sixes on their face have red backs, then one inference that could be made is that the card with the 6 on it has a red back. That's pretty obvious. But there are other inferences we could make too, like that there shouldn't be any cards with a 6 and a back that isn't red. Now, that last inference is crucial to getting the right answer, but it's pretty hard to make because there's a couple of no's in there and negation comes at a processing cost. So if people base their decisions about which cards to check on the inferences that they can derive from the rule, then that last costly inference will end up low on relevance and people won't check the blue card. But here's the thing, if we either lower the effort involved or boost the effect, we can actually push people to make that last inference and turn over the blue card to make sure there's no 6 there. How? Well, just invent a scenario that explicitly limits the possible colors to red and blue. With only 2 colors, that last inference could be reworded as, there are no cards with a 6 and a blue back. Since there's only one no in there, it's a lot easier to get to, and therefore much more relevant. The experimenters also created contexts where the effect of that inference was much higher. Like, tell people some 6s mistakenly got printed on cards whose backs weren't red, thus breaking the rule. In that case, it gets more important, more relevant, for subjects to check the blue card and make sure there's no 6 on it. Sure enough, when the effort was low and the effect was high, the rate of correct responses skyrocketed to nearly 60%. But in cases where the experimenters rendered the effort high and the effect low, fewer than 5% of subjects got it right. So experiments like these show how these small shifts in the phrasing or the scenario change how people interact with the language coming their way. The cards may be abstract, but they show how just by nudging people one way or another, we can really make it easier to get the messages we want across. And it's not hard to think of lots of ways that that could be relevant. So we've reached the end of the Ling space for this week. If you are my companion on this pragmatic journey, you learned that we need specific enough hypotheses about pragmatics to test our prediction. That we're more likely to make an inference if it's relevant, meaning that it's low in effort and high in effect. And that relevance theory helps explain how we reason about what people mean from what they say. The Ling Space is produced by me, Moti Lieberman, and directed by Van Lies Clevo. This week's episode was written by Stefan Hernebees. Our editor is Georges Coulomb, our music is by Shane Turner, and our graphics team is Atelier Muse. We're down in the comments below, or you can bring the discussion back over to our website where we'll have some extra material on this topic. Check us out on Tumblr, Twitter, and Facebook, and try dropping by our store. And if you want to keep expanding your own personal Ling space, please subscribe. And we'll see you next Wednesday. Upgatukama!